morning and welcome to First Presbyterian Church. If you're a guest with us this morning, how delighted we are that you're here and hope that you will experience what we pray to experience this morning. That is a movement of the Holy Spirit as we worship this great God. I have a couple of announcements I want to share with you. First of all, at 5 p.m. this afternoon, we have frontline prayer. There's a snack supper involved in that. It's in St. Andrew's Hall. We'll be praying for our mission, for our missionaries, for the vision of the church. So if you have the time this afternoon, I want to encourage you to come and take part in that. Also, we talk a lot about our children here, but we have a lot of families who are foster care parents now, and they need help. Sometimes they just need enough time to go to the grocery store alone. Or maybe it's even overnight, but if you have some time in your busy schedule and you'd like to help some of these foster care parents out, there's an announcement in here. I want to encourage you to take a look at that and make the contact and offer that as a part of your way to serve God and to serve the church. Now, with that in mind, would you now take a moment and prepare your hearts for worship?
Thy presence, my light. Be thou my wisdom, be thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, and I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. High King of heaven, when the battle is done, and heaven's joys to me, O bright heaven's sun. Christ of my own heart, whatever befalls, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
We invite you to stand as we worship this ruler and redeemer who calls us into his presence. May the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. May they be happy and joyful. Sing to God, sing praise to his name. Extol him who rides on clouds. Rejoice before him. His name is the Lord. Father to the fatherless, a defender of widows, is God in his holy dwelling. The Lord be with you. Let us worship this redeeming God.
Thank you.
God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are here this morning because the Son, our Savior, has paid the debt and has made us free. We come willing this morning. So we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come and envelop this worship service as we sing, as we praise, pray, and preach to your honor and glory. We pray this in the name of our Savior who loved us to death, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen. This morning, our confession of faith taken from the great ancient Apostles' Creed. So I want to ask you this morning, Christian, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Victory in Christ means this morning we have the pleasure and the privilege to come before him and to confess our sins with the assurance that he will not only hear them, but will forgive us. If you're able, would you kneel now for a time of personal confession? Join me now for our corporate confession. Heavenly Father, you asked for my hands that you might use them for your purpose. I gave them for a moment, then withdrew them, for the work was hard. You asked for my mouth to speak against injustice. I gave you a whisper that I might not be accused. You asked for my eyes to see the pain of poverty. I closed them, for I did not want to see. You asked for my life that you might work through me. I gave a small part that I might not get too involved. Lord, forgive my calculated efforts to serve you, only when it is convenient for me to do so, only in those places where it is safe to do so, and only with those who make it easy to do so. Father, forgive me, renew me, send me out as stable instrument, that I might take seriously the meaning of your cross. Amen. Hear this assurance of pardon from 1 Peter. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. For by his wounds you have been healed. In that great assurance, let's stand as we continue to worship.
Please continue in prayer with me now. Father, we're so thankful just for those brief moments of silence. Just to be in your presence quietly with little distraction except the thoughts in our head or the distractions of sin that so easily entangles us. And yet we know, Lord, there's no peace apart from you. There's no peace in this world apart from your presence and the reassurance that you've taken away all of our sin. Our hearts are heavy this morning as we think of those without peace in Cuba, Haiti, and the Bahamas, for those who've left their homes in evacuations in Florida and the coastal Georgia and South Carolina. For people, Lord, who wonder, will they have a home when they return? For families who've lost loved ones, they cry for peace and there is no peace. We recognize, Lord, were it not for your intervention by the cross, there would be no peace and there'd be no healing and there would be no hope. And we're here today thanking you, Lord, in the midst of that silence, that you are not silent. In the midst of that quiet, that you are not quiet. You've spoken loudly to us of your love and your commitment to redeem a rebellious people. We know that because you sent your Son, the Lord Jesus, into our broken world to set us on a healing trajectory. May that healing trajectory be our mission as we seek to advance the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. Help our missionaries in Haiti, all of the missionaries and churches of the cross of the Lord Jesus. Be merciful to those as they grieve and help us to help others to put back their lives in order. Thank you for our disaster relief team that was recently in Louisiana helping those flood victims and who already looked for ways to help these that have been displaced in our own city. We are so thankful for many in our congregation and for the churches in this city and for the Red Cross and others who've mobilized, the school systems that have mobilized to show mercy for those who have been displaced. Thank you for those, even like Jason Medlin, who've organized a worship service this morning in many of the high schools around the city. Thank you that they displaced people from the coast are asking for Bibles. Let us be first responders as well, Lord, looking for ways that we can meet needs and point people to the only hope that we have in the midst of our distress, which is the Lord Jesus. Be near those who are distressed because of sickness and death. We continue to pray for Alice and Chris Cawley and the Beeman family, Mary Donna and Hal Beeman III, the death of their father Hal on October the 1st. Thank you for his faithfulness as a member and an elder for over 40 years here at First Presbyterian. We continue to pray for Gary Lentz, who will be having surgery, for Mickey Willis. We also pray for those battling illness. Continue to pray for Nancy Matzinger and Alan Blaylock, Leanne Bird, Renee Foss, and Rod Vesey. We continue to lift up the persecuted church. Every day for them is a displaced day. Every day is a disorienting day. Thank you that they have the Holy Spirit. They have your scriptures. They have one another. But Lord, protect them and use us as brothers and sisters in Christ to not only provide strength for them, but also to join them in taking the cross to a broken and rebellious world. Thank you for Roger and Shirley Brown, their commitment to spread the gospel throughout Africa. Continue to use them as they deal with trauma and counsel those who have been displaced. Make us people living on mission by the cross. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus, and we use the words that he gave his disciples to pray when we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated and please pass the friendship pack.
I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook, and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take my sin, and sings my soul.
How great thou art!
peace of the Lord be always with you. Share that peace with one another.
Love and sorrow. turn your Bibles to Mark chapter 8.
We read in verses 31 through 38. That's found on page 1566 in the Bible provided you in the pew. In the 1970s, Paul Hebert went as a missionary to Asia, and there he was wrestling with the question, what is the minimum we should ask or expect someone outside of Christianity to embrace before we could call them a Christian? For example, what if a person's never read the Bible? What if a person only had a few or no, very few Christian friends? What if they'd only heard the gospel once? Could that person become a Christian? He was really asking the question, how much is enough? When he returned to the U.S. in the 1970s, he noticed a different context here. He began to wonder, are we asking not too little, but are we asking too much? He noticed that churches were focused on distinctions about belief and behavior and expectations. And so he was wrestling with this idea of, well, how much is too much to ask before we consider this person a believer? And he used set theory from mathematics, and Hebert proposed that the best understanding of Christianity is not what he applied or called bounded set theory, but what he called centered set theory. Bounded set theory in mathematics is just static theory. It's the idea that obviously there are boundaries, and that Christians are those people who affirm right beliefs and practice right behavior, and those that do not are not Christians. Centered set theory is dynamic. It's a little bit different. It's more about movement into a particular direction, and particularly movement toward the center. Christians that are moving towards Jesus rather than moving away from Jesus. Others like Donald McGilchrist and more recently Donald Carson have spoken about bounded set versus centered set understanding of discipleship. So I want you to ask this morning, do you take a bounded set approach in your understanding of discipleship? Or do you have a centered set approach to your understanding of discipleship? Are you setting expectations for God, and do you believe He has expectations for you? Or are you centered in on a goal? As we read through this passage here in Mark 8, what you're going to see, what we will see, is that Jesus describes a discipleship that is centered towards moving us into a deeper and deeper relationship with Him. And to have a centered set experience with God, the cross of Jesus has got to be centered into our experience. So let's read in Mark chapter 8. We'll begin in verse 31. This is right after Jesus has asked the disciples, "Who do men say that I am?" Peter says, you remember the response, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then here in verse 31, he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. When Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." And he said to them, "I tell you the truth, some of you who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God come with power." Let's pray together. Father, would you teach us Would you show us from your word what it means to be centered in a relationship with you? And teach us the prominent role that the cross plays in not only our understanding of you, but in our proper response to you. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Is Christianity growing or is it shrinking in America? A Pew Research study here recently gave some conflicting facts. One set of facts says that the percentage of population that would self-identify as Christian is shrinking to the general population. But at the same time, other statistics say that evangelical Christianity is growing. In the last decade, almost more than 10 million, up to 62 million people. So how is it? Are we shrinking or are we growing? Well, I think the answer, at least from the Pew study, is that nominalism in the church is disappearing. And when I say nominalism, I'm saying that people who once self-identified themselves as Christians, but who now find that it's not socially or professionally beneficial to, or it's not advantageous to them to identify as a Christian, they're moving away from the faith. But what's interesting is as skepticism grows, evangelical, robust Christianity is growing in America. Tim Keller calls it, we're losing the mushy middle, and yet what's emerging, even as skepticism is growing, is a more robust and focused Christianity. I might propose that it's bounded set thinking in Christianity that's eroding and disappearing, and yet centered set thinking is growing. And as I analyze the churches that are not growing, they're either very, very rigid in terms of their approach to behavior and prescription of attitude and action, or they're so loose, they just give a general whimsical, God loves everybody, God loves you, let's try to provide love. But really, both of those are bounded set approaches. I've been working with college students for over 30 years, and as I watch students hit snags in their spiritual pilgrimage, more times than not, I began to realize that they have a bounded set approach to their understanding of Christianity. What I mean by that is that they have a general idea that I will do certain things and God will do certain things for me. And as I do those things, He will respond and reciprocate certain things that I want. And then things don't go their way. And then they hit a wall. And then they begin to question, is this really for me? You know, it's a question that the church needs to wrestle through. Parents of young teenagers, really a church full of millennials, we need to wrestle through this idea as millennials are less interested in loyalty to institutions and they have more of a commitment to their own individuality. How do we help them understand that Christianity actually is in their best interest? I do believe that it's tied to understanding a centered set approach to Christianity. I taught recently a parenting class in the student families class, and I taught about really this idea that you need to parent the heart and you need to parent in relationship. I was really talking about a centered set approach to Christianity, not a prescribed rules approach, but a centered set approach. I believe the Pharisees, as we read and how Jesus dealt with them, very harshly, the Pharisees had a bounded set understanding of Christianity. So they had a certain set of expectations that they had on God and certain expectations they would put on other people. But here Jesus says discipleship is centered set. And what helps us stay centered on our understanding of God and helps us stay clear on our response to God is the cross of Jesus Christ. He not only describes His cross, but He tells us to take up our cross. And He doesn't just say that it's to be peripheral. He says, take up your cross daily. It's essential to have the cross as central to your relationship with God, because you won't understand what God is doing in your life, nor will you understand how to respond to Him if the cross is not central. So if you can see on your outline, I want to look at how the cross changes our view
of progress. It changes our view of power, and it changes our view of purpose as the cross stays central to our experience. I'll quote the verse again. If any man wishes to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Jesus is making it very clear that the cross reveals God and changes our view of progress, or we could say our view of success. You know, Christianity is unique from all other religions because Christianity is both personal and relational. Think about that. There's no other religion that claims nor points people to this reality, that Christianity is both personal and relational. And it came at a great cost for God to reconcile the broken relationship that we had with Him. It's uniquely personal and uniquely relational. What's the alternative to a cross-centered relationship? Well, it's really bartering with God. It's a sense of bartering where we employ this idea that we will do certain things and God will do other things for us. Think about Mark 18. We talk about the rich young man or the rich young ruler. He was bartering with Jesus, wasn't he? He said, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said, "Keep the commandments." And he said, just kind of, you might say superficially, "Oh, I've kept all the commandments. And what more must I do?" Jesus recognized he was bartering. He said, "Go and sell all that you own, give to the poor, and then you will find treasure in heaven, and you come follow me." Isn't that interesting? Yes, go and sell what you possess, but you follow me. Instead of bartering for me to meet certain expectations of you, are you really understanding what a relationship with God is about? Jesus says, if any man wishes to come after me, deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. Christianity is about a relationship with Jesus. It's not about bartering for what we can get from God by what we give. Think about John 4, where the woman at the well is confronted by Jesus. She's bartering. And she's bartering, saying, "Is my spirituality, is my religion enough for you?" And Jesus says, he didn't say, "Go sell us possessions." What does he say? "Go to you, who is your husband? Go tell your husband." And she says, "I'm not with my husband." And Jesus said, "That's right. You've been bartering for a sense of contentment in your life, going from one man to the next, from one person to the next, hoping that somehow or another that's going to bring you life. That life is found in me." What does he say? "Anyone comes to me, out of that relationship will they find the innermost satisfaction of living water." I think about bartering this way. If I took out my keys to my car here, and we're going to barter with you a little bit, and I said, "I'm going to give you the keys to my 1997 Toyota Camry. It does have a little door click opener there. Good news is that it has not had the passenger side airbags recalled. The bad news is there's no passenger side airbags." But that 212,000 mile car, I might say, "I'd like to give this to you as a gift." Well, let's just say you said, "Okay, I'll take that gift. Here's $50. Well, it is an old car. It does have a lot of miles. But it's worth a little bit more than $50. Do you see how offensive bartering is? Well, you might say, "That's just an old car, Mike." But let's say maybe it's this. "You give me your keys and I'll give you my keys. And we'll swap cars. Let's barter." And you would say, "No, no. My car's worth a lot more than your car, Mike. That's a bad deal. Your car is not worth very much. I'm not sure if I could get home in it." What's the point here? We barter with God. We make an evaluation. Is this going to be worth it for me? Is the return greater than the cost? And really, what we're offering is very, very pitiful compared to the inestimable gift that's been given to us. That's why bartering is so offensive to God. Jesus said, the only way to know me in relationship, the only way to know me in relationship is through receiving me as a gift. Receiving me as a gift. Well, is there a power in the universe that can transform followers of Christ from those who would barter for their relationship to those who would receive God's offer as a gift? Yes, there is a power. There is one. It's the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's doing so much good in the world, I wish more people could spread it around. But you know, the cross not only is the key to understanding progress, the cross is the key to understanding power. If you look here in the passage, Jesus says, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily. Take up his cross daily and follow me. He's really asking, what are you sacrificing for? What are you willing to give up? What are you willing to put on the line? You know, Jesus' discipleship teaches us to unlearn the fall and to relearn the kingdom. And the way we do that is by the cross. It leads to a commitment and willingness to sacrifice, to give, to let go of our selfishness, to let go of our fear, and to let go of our power. The gospel always moves us away from our comfort, and it always moves us toward need. Where do we get that power to move away from our self-oriented comfort, our self-protection, our self-promotion, our self-ambitions? Where do we get that power? And to move towards laying down our life and taking up our cross. Well, it comes from his cross. Think about Mark chapter 14. It's 2 days before the crucifixion. And there's a woman who enters the house where Jesus and his disciples are resting. And she has a very expensive bottle of perfume. And she begins to pour that perfume on Jesus' head. The disciples stop her. And they say, wait. That perfume could be sold and the money could be given to the poor. You're wasting that. You're wasting that on him. Jesus says, don't stop. Allow her to continue. She's done a good thing. She's anointed my head for burial. She understands the centrality of the cross. And it's willing to it's transforming her into a self-absorbed, self-protecting, fearful person to one who would be extravagantly sacrificial. Think about how she could use that expensive perfume to secure some power in her life. She could sell it for some kind of a better living. She could sell it to secure some kind of stable family life. I don't know. We're not told. But she's willing to give up her power, to let go of her power, and to sacrifice it in order to secure a deeper relationship with him. You know, there's so much racial tension in our nation, and there's a lot of reasons for it. I don't want to in any way try to give a simple answer to it. Obviously, fear, selfishness. But I think a lot of it is about power. A good deal of it is about power. It's about superiority and maintaining our sense of control, whatever that means. Maybe it's mask and disagreement or misunderstanding. A lot of it's about power. We've been in a discussion group once a month on racial reconciliation. And we'll be talking about this next month, this idea of what does it mean to give up power? And what makes us feel that we have the right to hold on to our power? I really think holding on to your power is holding on to a sense of superiority where you ultimately believe that you're better or more deserving than another person. I saw some research about marriage conflict recently. John Gottman and others have done research, an interesting research about why marriages break up and how what causes marriages to break up, what causes marriages to stay. And the Gottman research discovered that marriages that ended in separation and divorce, between 40 and 60% of marital conflict was unresolved. So close to 40 and sometimes 60% of conflict in marriage of those who ended up divorced and separated, the conflict went unresolved. Conversely, when they studied marriages that stayed together, they found that around 40 to 60% of conflicts in marriages of people who stay together go unresolved. Fascinating, isn't it? Basically, what the research shows is that people that stay together disagree just as much as the people who break up, but they found some way to let go of their power and to move towards the other person. They know something about forgiveness. They know something about not making big deals out of small things. Somehow they found a way to move towards that person because they don't believe they're superior or that they have the right answers or they know more. They value the relationship. Jesus says that if we're going to know anything about the cross, we got to let go of our power. 1 Corinthians 4 says it this way: who regards you as superior? And what do you have that you did not receive? And if you did receive it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it? Even your advantage and superiority is a gift from God. And it should lead you to humility. And it should lead you to letting go of your control. Is there a power in this nation that can take self-absorbed, self-protecting, self-righteous people and then turn them into disciples who are willing to deny themselves? Yes, there is one. Thank God there's one. The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ doing so much good, we need more people spreading it around. You see, the cross changes our view of progress. The cross changes our view of power, but it also changes our view of purpose. Jesus said it this way: he who saves his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will find it. Where do you find that kind of motivation to love people sacrificially? Where do you find that kind of motivation to lay your life down for others who may not love you back? Where does it come from? It comes from the cross right here. And Jesus is saying there's basically two kinds of people. They're life grabbers and they're life givers. Life grabbers see life as an opportunity to gain what they want. And life givers see life as an opportunity to bless and help others gain life. Only in the cross can we find that kind of motivation. Only in the cross will we find a kind of love in our own hearts that allow us to love others in that deep way. There's a story of a king in Europe years ago in a small country called the Lochranes. His name was Vesusius, and he had decreed that anyone breaking a law that he was reinforcing, the penalty would be that they would have their eyes put out. And the story goes that the next person to break that law was his son. And he was really struggling with what to do when he found that it was his son who had disobeyed him and broken that law. He said, if I do not punish him, then the people will believe that my law is unjust and I don't have a high view for the law. But if I do punish him, he's my son, and I desperately want to show him mercy. So what he decided to do was to put one of his son's eyes out. And he's concluded this: every time someone looked at his son, they would see in that dead eye that he was serious about justice and serious about holiness. But every time they would see that his son could see out of his other eye, they would realize he's a king full of mercy. Is that how God has loved us? He didn't just put one eye out. He didn't just put both eyes out. He said, so you will know how much you're loved, how much you're loved. My son goes to a cross. Now that cross was an emblem. That cross was a humiliation, an emblem of torture and shame. It wasn't just taking his life. It was humiliating and shaming him. And Jesus says, discipleship is to take up your cross daily. He uses that kind of language. I find it interesting in John 21, after the resurrection, Peter's gone back to what he was comfortable with before he met Jesus. He's back fishing, and he's out in the boat trying to catch fish, and a man comes to the shore, and actually it's Jesus, and he says the same thing that he had said to him the first time he met him. He says, cast your nets on the other side. Just imagine that Peter is right back where he was. And Jesus comes and finds him in the midst of his mess, in the midst of his unbelief. Maybe it's shame. Maybe it's a sense that God could never use me. I had denied him. But when Peter recognizes that it's Jesus who says, put your nets on the other side, what did he do? We won't look it up now, but go read it. It says he jumped in the water. The other guys rowed to the shore. He swam to the shore because there was Jesus. He hadn't left him. He hadn't forsaken him. And he comes to the shore. Jesus prepares food for them. They sit down in fellowship. And what does Jesus ask him? He says, do you love me? He asked him that three times. I'm sure that reminded Peter of those three times that he denied Jesus. But he said, a relationship with me is about love. Do you get it now, Peter? Do you understand it's about love? Is there a power in the universe that can take life grabbers and make them life givers? Yes, there's one. Thank God there's one. What if there were none? The gospel of Jesus Christ is doing so much good. Let's be people who are committed to spreading it around. Let me close by asking you a few questions about your response. He says here, we're to deny ourselves, take up our cross daily, and follow him. That starts with surrender. And I think about it almost cyclically. It's surrender, which states in our surrender that we trust you, Jesus. But then repentance, when we failed and turned away from him, is altogether once again saying, we take you, Jesus. We trust you, Jesus. That's surrender. We take you, Jesus, when we've repented. Repentance is not just admitting I've gotten off the track. Repentance is saying something else has been more important to me than you. I've loved something or someone, my progress, my power, my purpose. I've loved it more than I've loved you. Repentance is letting go and taking him all over again. But it says that we have to do that daily. That tells me that we leak. Our love leaks. Our motivation leaks. And while I definitely believe that worship is vital, Lord's Day by Lord's Day, this verse tells me that's not enough. It's not enough to just come to church once a week. While it's vital and it does fuel our understanding, Jesus says, take up your cross daily. What are you doing to grow your daily communion with him? One other thing I would say in light of your response to God, are you being deliberate in your pursuit of Christ-centered living? We call that discipleship. Doesn't mean you have to be in a discipleship group, but what are you doing by way of deliberate pursuit of Christ-centered living? You know, without the cross, you have no progress. You have no power. You have no purpose. What are you doing in Christ-centered pursuit? Let me ask you this. Are you bartering with God? In what ways are you bartering with God? In what ways has a superior attitude caused you to distance yourself from other people? What's keeping you from being willing to let go of your pride and move towards that person and forgive them? Are you life-grabbing versus life-giving? Well, I do want to just tell you about some people in this congregation. We have a congregation full of people who are life-givers. Just humbled once again this week by seeing you pouring yourself out for others. As you know, that many people have been displaced to our city. A lot of them are in hotels and maybe had families or relationships that they could connect to all up and down, moving away from the coast. But many people had nothing. And they've been placed in gymnasiums and high schools around this city. 400 and 500 people in Josie High School, in Richmond Academy, in Butler High School. And our church has been deployed in mission. Just a little message that there's a need, and people were on the move, taking physical help to them, serving them food. The Red Cross has done a phenomenal job here. But even last night, Jason Medlin called me and said, we're trying to organize worship services for these people and making sure that churches are deployed so that people without their homes and maybe not knowing if their home's going to be there when they return can worship. Life givers that are committed to sharing the cross with others. You know, we just had a disaster relief team return from Louisiana, and Billy English, there was 9 of them down there, and he said, you know, we got to get ready and be prepared to deploy it on the East Coast now. But he talked about how they were able to love people in Christ's name and share the gospel and help them building their homes back, or their homes had been totally, the insides of their homes been destroyed by the floods. You know, it doesn't just happen in disaster relief. We have people that are regularly volunteering and pouring themselves out for tutoring and mentoring kids at Craig Halton Elementary. People pouring themselves out at Sand Hills. One member just has had a burden for years for driving past Sand Hills community. And so she's organized gifts and organized a way to minister to teachers at Tuck Middle School and A. Brian Mary. She recently has gotten approval for release time, which is an opportunity to teach the Bible in the public schools. And a number of our members are meeting weekly with Tuck Middle School students. Where's the motivation for that? Where's the desire? Where does that come from? That they want to be a life giver. They hear about a need and they don't move towards comfort. They move towards need. Well, is there a power in the universe that can turn self-absorbed people into life-giving gospel disciples? Yes, there's one. Thank God there's one. What if there were none? The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come join me in spreading it around. Let's pray together. Father, we're humbled that in our disaster relief need, you came and found us. We were displaced. We had no healing or hope. And you came and found us, and you made us your own. We're part of the family. And Lord, it's such a great privilege to extend your gospel hope to a broken and rebellious world. Use us, Father, meager gifts that we offer. Use our lives. Advance your work through us, we pray. Make us courageous and sacrificial disciples of the Lord Jesus. Not as those who would barter with you, not because of any superiority, as Paul said, we're the least of all, but simply, Father, because you've loved us. We want to feed your sheep because you've loved us. Give us that power and that privilege, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. you're not sure that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ and really understand the cross, I'll be waiting as well as some elders with me at the back of the church sanctuary. I'd love to talk to you. Raise your hands, believer, and receive God's benediction. Believer in Christ, may you never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, of which we have been crucified to the world and the world to us. Go in the strength and power of the cross. Amen.